see you all again. I guess there are three kinds of fasts. There's satyagraha fasts, and there's penitential fasts, and then there's can't hold down any food fasts. I had the third kind, and I thought at first it would be a lot of fun, but it was no fun at all. When Gandhi says, "I'm entering the fiery gates," when he started on a fast, it was no exaggeration. It really is a kind of torment. So I'm really sorry that I sent around a course web message saying there would be no class, and then I realized this is a perfect talk for Eli to give, and he agreed, and by that time I was way too sick to remember to send you another course web, and it might have been too late anyway. So some of you missed Eli's presentation of the basic models that I find helpful to look at the development of religious consciousness in the West for signs of where we can see nonviolence growing. I know some of you missed that, but it is on the web. It's on the webcast. I sat in my sick bed and watched it yesterday. I hope you all are feeling very sorry for me. And what I'd like to do today, and this will leave us right on schedule, let's just pick up the conversation where Eli left it with you on Tuesday. I'd like to embellish and focus on a few things a little bit more, bring in a point or two, and I was not able to hear your questions. That was the only problem with the webcast. So if you'd like to discuss them further, I'm really happy to do that. And then when the campanile strikes three, we will seek not to find for whom the bell tolls, but instead take stock. If we have some time at that point, I would like to go into this fascinating question of the Jesus of history and what kind of nonviolent light that casts on what the Christian religion was to have been. And then, if we can do that in about 10 minutes, I'm going to go over the midterm for about 10 minutes. I don't think I need more than that. And then we'll stop early and spread out the books, and you can get them. The midterm was on the whole very good. I think there was a big range of grades. And my guess is, although this is an untested hypothesis, my guess is that people who studied very hard got higher grades than people who did not. It's just my theory. So the first question that came up, let me say one thing about the midterms before I get into this stuff. I want to remind you that if you don't do well in the midterm but you do well on the final, you're in pretty good shape because the final grade kind of phagocytizes the midterm grade. If you did well on the midterm, and some of you did very, very well, we're going to practice non-crowing. That's like non-embarrassment. It means you're not going to, you know, kick back and say, this course is a gut, I don't have to study, because it's going to be cumulative on the final, and there's a psychological phenomenon that happens where people do very well in the midterm, they lose their moral fiber, and they don't do well in the final, and they do badly for the course. So psychologically, if you did well on the midterm, you can be happy about that and be glad that you know how to do these exams, but keep on doing it. All right. So the first question that I picked up from Tuesday is, was this theory of mine about three stages of religion, incidentally, Nagler's theory of religion was sort of a joke. Didn't mean it to be like, you know, up there on the marquee playing this week, Nagler's theory of religion. But it is good to know that it was my theory, so you don't confuse it with something that's accepted in general by the academic community, because it is not. Though Herbert Spencer, the philosopher, also came up with a very similar theory, I understand. But this theory that people at first see the source of power that should be worshipped and propitiated and harnessed in the natural environment, and then they proceed to a stage where it's more vivid for them in their community. And then finally, and I do mean this to be a progression, an improvement, a growth, an evolution, if you will, people begin to discover the source of reality within them. Now, in a sense, this is cumulative, because when you discover the reality within you, it doesn't mean you don't see it anymore anywhere else. But the location of reality within the human person, in addition to its tremendous ramifications for nonviolence and violence, it's an effective discovery because that's where this reality is most accessible to us. As you can worship trees until the cows come home, that's a nice image. You know, you'll probably have a nice, robust, safe environment to grow up in, but you will not make the final realization of where the source of reality is and where happiness is coming from until you realize that reality that you're worshiping in the tree is also in you, and that you're closer to you than the tree. So hard as it is to discover this reality, it's easier to discover it within you than anywhere else. Gandhi, for example, had three rules for successful prayer, which again, he didn't write up in any one place, but you can put it together from various remarks he made, and this is a very interesting list. First, the prayer has to be selfless. So, for example, you could be praying, God, get the British off our backs, you know, or like that famous prayer in Fiddler on the Roof, may this blessing for the Tsar, may the Lord bless him and keep him far away from us. So if you're praying that because you just want them out of your face, it's not entirely a selfless prayer. If you're aware that it's not doing them any good to be in your country dominating you and exploiting you, it's actually partly for their welfare that you want them to be relieved of the burden of empire, it's a selfless prayer. The second criterion is it has to be done with a great deal of concentration. It's not like, oh Lord, I hope we have world peace. Now what's going on in Venezuela today? That won't work. She is not listening. And thirdly, and this is why I bring it up here, you have to have some awareness that the entity to whom you're addressing the prayer is within you. Otherwise, it's just like you're going and shouting into the wrong room. So the first question came up about these three stages was, did I mean this to apply to religious development everywhere? And the answer is, I guess so, but I haven't really thought about it. I haven't thought about religion in China, which is very special. I haven't thought about most nature religions, of which there are some examples in Africa that are monotheistic and very advanced, even though they are nature-centered, and I haven't really thought about any of that. I'm thinking about mainly our experience in the West, and I am including India, where you meet with an advanced kind of monotheism at the very earliest stage, almost. I mean, there's some very early Vedic hymns, probably about, 2000 BC, which seem to be pure nature religion, polytheistic in nature, but very soon you have a special type of monotheism for which a word was invented. Oh, you're wearing your Oedipus shirt. That's going to be very convenient for us. You're going to have to get up and get you on camera at some point. Yeah. Okay. a term was invented by, a Sanskrit scholar, Max Müller, kathenotheism, which is sort of a made-up word from Greek, and it would mean God by God-ism. In other words, whichever God that you're worshiping is the God. So if you hymn to Indra, Indra is the supreme deity in the universe. A hymn to Agni, although in the pantheistic worldview, Agni is just the god of fire. In an advanced worldview, Agni is the supreme reality as fire, and so forth. So that's my answer to the first question is basically, I don't know. I haven't really thought about other religious environments than the West. And then the other question that I picked up was about monotheism, and you quite understandably said, am I saying, I am the Nagler of Nagler's theory of religion, by the way, am I saying that where you have monotheism, you have nonviolence, and where you have policy is around violence. No, no, obviously not, because look around you. I mean, just look at the front page of the newspaper, and you'll know we do not have a nonviolent world. The analogy is this, though, and I'm really glad you brought this up because it hasn't quite occurred to me before. The analogy is very much to what we were talking about in connection with quantum theory. Quantum theory pulls the philosophical underpinnings out from under any plausible worldview which could endorse violence. Okay? If you have a materialistic worldview, it means we're all separate. We can tell we're separate because we have separate bodies. I mean, look at my body's sitting up here on the desk. Shannon's body is way back there in the audience. So obviously we're separate, so assumedly I could do something to hurt Shannon and it wouldn't hurt me. But the mere thought of that is actually something that I shrink from and I would not do. So when you can show that even from a scientific standpoint that the world is not made of separate material particles, it really, philosophically, it takes away the basis for violence. Okay? Now, in the same way, but in a more important way, monotheism takes away the religious support for violence. Because if you have a real polytheistic religious belief system, you believe there's different gods. So you live in Athens and your god is Athena, and the Lacedaemonians worship Ares or something. That means there's a fundamental split in the universe, and these two forces can be opposed to one another, and there can be a zero-sum struggle between them at the deepest level of reality. But when you say no, as the Jews said some remote time in antiquity, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, hear people, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, then you no longer have that structure. You can no longer say, you can't really say, though people are going to go on saying it for sure, you can't really say it's the God of the Hebrews against the God of the Canaanites, because guess what? It's the same God, really. But does that change everything all at once? Of course not, because people are plagued with a neurotic condition known as cognitive dissonance, and they say one thing, they do another, and they think a third. But at least it puts a framework out there. It sets a goal, as Eli was stressing on Tuesday. We now see that paradise is in the future, not in the past. And that means we have a responsibility of growing towards it. We have a responsibility to realize this fact that the supreme reality is one and it unites all of us. So it's a very handy thing and it's out there, and the question is at what rate of speed people are going to catch on to it. Yeah?
Where do you place atheism?
Atheism kind of places itself outside this whole framework. But there's a difference, of course, between atheism and agnosticism. And I think mostly what we're talking about is agnosticism, because atheism, like the root of I swear by God that there is no God, is kind of, it is in some way self-contradictory. You know, it's been said that an atheist is someone who goes down to the very basement of his consciousness and knocks on the door and says, is there anybody here? And hears a voice saying, no. He says, I told you so. So, I mean, in reality, what we're mostly talking about when we say atheism is agnosticism. And that just means, in a modern context, it just means we haven't found a religious commitment that makes any sense to us. And I still think it's a matter of intuition as to whether we think that, you know, we're fundamentally connected with other people or not. Let me give you an example, not of exactly this, but something that might help. There are about 20 institutions, organizations in the world that are doing third-party nonviolent intervention. And about half of them are faith-based groups, Christian peacemaker teams, Muslim peace fellowship, Jewish peace fellowship, Buddhist peace fellowship, etc. And the other half are atheistic. They're noncommittal regarding any faith proposition. But the fact is they're doing exactly the same thing. They're risking their life to save the lives of people who they're not even related to. So spiritually, they're deeply religious people, but they don't belong to any structured faith commitment, because sometimes today, none of these structured faith commitments work for us. And that's partly a result of the fact that we're all mushed together today, so we are in contact with one another's religions, and that's very confusing. And it's partly because of materialism, and it's partly because of the third stage in that descending hierarchy that Eli was talking about, where we've gone from revelation to accommodation to co-optation. Very quickly, honest people are quite fed up with all the religions that they see around them, but they still have the same feeling for oneness, and it's that feeling that we're talking about. Now, in the ancient world, it was simpler, though, because it wasn't less bloody, but it was simpler in that you mostly had a framework for your beliefs. Okay? Yes, go ahead. I think what Joy is saying, and that nobody heard, is correct, that there are modern nature-based religions which are only apparently polytheistic, but are really pantheistic in the Hindu sense, that they're seeing the same God in all forms of life. I think that's true. Yeah. But mind you, what I was starting to talk about here is our history, and I'll work our way up to our modern condition. Okay? Now, you know, I'm looking around carefully for any questions, and I'm happy to go slowly, especially since I'm still in recovery. But I did want to talk a little bit about ritual and especially animal sacrifice in connection with Girard's famous model. What we're going to be concerned about is not so much stage one, where it's still with us in a sense and there's no documentation for it really anyway, but it's that shift from stage two to stage three, where the community is worshipped to the individual is worshipped, that really breaks loose a huge new possibility for nonviolence. And as I'm sure you're aware, I don't think we've really completely made that shift yet. But I think that this is what Jesus was all about. This is what the Buddha was all about. And it's not a coincidence that in terms of social institutions, both Jesus and the Buddha, and this is one of the few things that's known for fairly certain about Jesus, they were both against animal sacrifice. And why is that? Well, partly for an obvious reason. If you see life everywhere, you feel for the suffering of animals, just pure compassion. Why are you killing these animals? They have absolutely nothing to do with it. I happen to be in a village on Crete once during a yorti, a festival. That's not too unusual. About every fourth or fifth day is a yorti somewhere in Greece. But this one was a big yorti in Crete, and they were going to have some meat, which they don't often have. And so I was sitting there in the village drinking coffee with the boys. I can't imagine I was actually getting paid for this, some kind of stupid research grant, but I was actually drinking coffee and singing folk songs with all of these my friends in the village square. And they brought this goat down from the mountain to be slaughtered. That animal was aware that something was going on. It was shaking, just trembling in every limb. And as it walked clattering on by me, my friend Andrea said, "Favati, favati davvero." Poor creature is afraid. So all human beings have mirror neurons, right? And they're aware when an animal is suffering and they feel bad when they kill it. But on the other hand, they want to eat. They eat meat. So they're going to do it anyway. So they invent an enormous fabrication, basically, to make it not only okay, but a religious requirement that they do this. And one of the powers that you have to deal with then in this process is the guilt. You have to deal with the guilt for killing the animal. So let's look at a particular ritual. I'm going to look at two Greek rituals. Oh, I completely forgot my announcements. I'll talk about them later. There was a ritual in ancient Greece called bouphonia, which is a very obvious to understand word. Phonia means a murder or a slaughter, and bou means ox. So this is the ox murder ritual. And there's two useful features that it has that we can learn from. One is the way they set it up. They would draw a sacred precinct, a big circle, and they say, no one is allowed inside this circle. And they would say that in Greek so that the people were okay with it. They understood that. And then they would sprinkle some barley on the altar, which was in the middle of the circle. And then they would release an ox outside the circle. Okay, for $64,000, what do you think the ox is going to do? Obviously, it's going to, hey, it's barley. The poor ox has not had Greek 10, does not know what has just been told, goes and eats the barley, at which point the priest and all of his administrators, they say, sacrilege, sacrilege. They run after the poor creature, and they slaughter it. And they barbecue it and distribute the meat, and as well as all its various very well-scripted components. But so the first feature is that the animal is tricked into innocently violating a regulation and making itself guilty. The second feature is the person who actually takes the machaira, the knife, and slaughters it, then has been infected by the guilt. So he has to run out of the community and throw the knife off a cliff into the sea, because the sea will purify the illumata, the pollution from the murder. And then he himself has to be exiled from the community for a period of, in some cases, 10 years. So this is all crazy, but that's how people work. You know? And what I'm trying to give us a sense of is the power of this kind of ritual. No contract was considered legally binding in the ancient world, stage two world, the community is sacred. No contract is binding if it's not sealed with a ritual of some kind. The most potent kind of ritual was an offering ritual, and the most potent kind of offering was where you killed an animal. And then there are further classifications of whether you burned it completely or eat it, but that ceases to become relevant for us. Hey, John? No, they do all this partly because they want to eat meat, and people, you know, some people do want to do that. And in some cases, it's important for their nutrition. But they also do it because of the Girardian model that Eli was telling you about on Tuesday. That, okay, once you've got this extreme power shift under your control in the culture, you can use it as the single reliable mechanism for keeping disruptive violence limited so that the community does not destroy itself. Because there have been communities where violence has gotten out of hand and they destroyed themselves. It happened on Easter Island, most probably. You have Hatfield and the McCoy kind of feuding gets out of hand. It could happen in Afghanistan. You need something before you have a body of agreed upon law to keep that violence in check. And the only way you can do it is with this stupid, ugly, pardon my value loading here, the stupid, ugly mechanism of scapegoating, which enables you to vent that violence in a unanimous way on a victim who cannot react back on the community. So you often choose, for example, this is pretty horrific, but you know, we're grown-ups here, you often choose orphans. Now, why do you choose orphans? Because they have no relatives, by definition. As George Bush says, most of our exports come from outside the country. Most orphans have no relatives. And because they have no relatives, there will be nobody to take revenge for them. That's why the Quran says, protect the orphan, because you have been protected when you have no protector. The Quran, in saying that, is actually making an explicit attempt. The prophet is doing exactly the same thing that Jesus, the earlier prophet, and Buddha did before him, which was to try to cancel out the sacrifice system, the scapegoating system, because of its horrific violence, which is actually self-repeating. So that's why this system is perpetuated. You had a question too. Oh, your name is?
Elizabeth.
The Greeks, in particular, that I know a little bit about, they did eat meat on other occasions other than part of a sacrifice, but they had a little way around that. They had what are called trapezomata, which are little depressions in the family table, and you would put aside a portion of everything for the gods. What exactly the gods did with it, I don't know. I suspect it was more of the rats that got to it. But you were, in a sense, sacrificing a little bit. But whether you only ate meat on that occasion or not, the sacrifice put the seal of approval, if you will, on all other occasions. Now, in early first century Palestine, the temple in Jerusalem had become just basically a huge abattoir, you know, just a slaughterhouse. People were going in there with everything they could get their hands on, your pigeons, sheep, goats, what have you. And this meant a living for the priests. It meant it was important for economic circulation of wealth, establishing the hierarchy of the community, as you did that in accordance with where people were standing and the ritual. And as I say, it enabled you to vent some of this unanimous violence. Okay. So there's one other feature of Greek sacrificial practice that I want to mention. And that is that in order for the system to work, you had to convince yourself that the victim was guilty. This is probably the most important feature in Girard's whole system. And you could do this in some pretty wacky ways. Either the victim is guilty or the victim actually wants to be sacrificed. And that's why you have these myths about how after sacrifice, the victim becomes deified, which, you know, is a very nice thing to happen. Sheep were often sacrificed in the Greek countries, Greek territories, and they would often bring the sheep forward to be sacrificed, and they would say to it, we're going to sacrifice you right now. Are you okay with that? And then they would sprinkle water on the sheep's head. Okay? Everybody ever sprinkle water on a sheep's head? What is a sheep going to do if you sprinkle water on its head? Exactly, like Ramadi, like that. You shake it off, okay? What's the gesture for yes in Greek? No is awesome. It's exactly the opposite from us. Off. But yes is ne. So I know how stupid this sounds, and it's not such a great idea to make fun of somebody else's religion, even if it's been dead for 2,000 years. But what I'm trying to emphasize is people are going to go to extreme lengths to construct a guilt or an acquiescence of the victim as a means of proving that the sacrifice was effective and of channeling the guilt so it's taken off from the community. Now, when you start getting into actually practicing this against human beings, you've got another situation. And for the system to work, you have to have a perfect victim. You've heard of the perfect storm. Well, we have the perfect victim in Mr. Oedipus, the fellow with the swollen foot. It proves already that there's something wrong with him. And you go right down the list, and he's violated every single possible prohibition and against being victimized. And he's the perfect victim, up to and including the fact that he actually punishes himself, so you don't have to take the knife and run 10,000 miles and throw it in the sea, all of that stuff. So as Eli was saying last time, Oedipus is, you know, here people have studied this play for 2,000 years, and it is extremely beautiful. I still remember, O Tecna Cadmu Tupalae Neotrophe. It's an extremely powerful play. Freud had some things to say about it, I gather, and there's probably some point to all of that also. And, you know, it's just a gut-wrenching, profound piece of literature. But when you get right down to it, folks, in terms of its social effect, it is a text of persecution. And it enables the community to go on persecuting. The plague afflicting the city of Thebes stands for violence running out of control. The investigator discovers that he himself is the victim, and he carries out his own punishment, and it's just perfect. So the minute that the victim can actually speak and say, hey, what the hell is going on here? Or as Job says, look, fellas, you can do whatever you want, but as far as I know, I didn't do any of those things that you're talking about. The system is busted wide open, and that's why Girard is very excited about this text, because he thinks here it shows you the Jews were trying to get away from the scapegoating process. There are other examples of that also in Jewish culture. There is a law in Deuteronomy which states that if someone has been accused of a crime and the entire community condemns that person, he is to be released. Why is that? Why would they have such a law, do you think? See, that shows you how cunning some of these mechanisms are. The reason is that if it were a real person committing a real crime, probably there'd be someone who would say he was innocent. If everybody's against him, what are we talking about? And Girard, it's unanimous violence. The community has picked him out as a scapegoat. Now notice how complicated this is. He may be actually guilty. And the fact is that we're going to see a lot of situations where there may be people who are actually guilty of real crimes, but the community is nonetheless treating them as a scapegoat, in the sense that they think that if they get rid of the person, they will get rid of the crime, get rid of the process. And that leads you directly to the modern criminal justice system, which is explicitly in California since 1976 based on retribution and not on rehabilitation. Okay. So this is, again, an example that the Jews were trying to, they had kind of instinctively recognized that the sacrificial system was causing a lot of violence, and they somehow were trying to get rid of it, and they recognized that you had these situations where everybody in the community feels like pointing to one person, blaming him or her, and that's got to be stopped. So now you come to Jesus, and he is walking along one day, and he sees a woman taken in adultery, and incidentally, sexual dysfunction or abnormality or I don't know what to call it, aberrant behavior. These are all constructed terms, partly. Sexually noticeable differences of some kind are almost always associated with the ritual victim. It has to be sacrificed for the purification of the community. That's why they're getting ready to stone this woman, because you can't touch her or you'll get infected by the guilt. So they're trying to kill her in the worst possible way, and I'm sorry to say this is actually being carried out for exactly the same crime, quote unquote, today in Iran. Just I'm trying to illustrate that these things have not yet gone away, right? They've been driven underground, but they're still with us, and it's important for us to be able to recognize them. So where are we? Jesus is coming along, and he sees this woman, and they're getting ready to stone her, and they don't know what he's going to do. He goes, he's thinking, I guess. I don't know if avatars think, but he seems to be thinking, writes something on the ground, and he stands up, and they have a tremendous respect for him. What is he going to say? He says, okay, whoever has no guilt can throw the first stone. Very clever, because if people had no guilt, they wouldn't care about the woman. Maybe that's her husband's problem. They have no interest in it, basically. Plus the fact, of course, that everybody has erred, and what we're doing is we're trying to offload our feeling of guilt onto a scapegoat. And incidentally, the term scapegoat is a Jewish term. It goes back to a practice where they would take a goat, and everybody in the community would lay hands on the goat and curse the goat. All of their guilt would go into the goat, and they would drive the goat out into the wilderness. Probably works as well as modern medicines, as far as I know. I'm rather bitter because they couldn't find any way to cure me this weekend. So, obviously, one of the main missions that Jesus felt that he had was to break open the sacrifice system. And that's undoubtedly why he had trouble with the temple authorities. You know the episode I'm referring to, where he'll go through the temple with a whip, driving out the money lenders, which some people think was not a very nonviolent thing to do, but I'm okay with it. He clearly had some of the Jewish, especially the Jewish religious authorities, on his case, and that may have been one of the things that led to his execution at a very early age. But now we come to the chilling line. This is going to be adding to what Matthew was saying, what Eli was saying last time. This line is from Matthew. As soon as I've stopped this, I'm going to stop and see if you had any questions from Tuesday or subsequently that we should talk about. This is Matthew 27, verse 25. Pilate has just finished the trial, and he's just literally washed his hands. That's his way of throwing the knife in the sea. He said, no guilt on this boy. And then he says to the Laos, the people, and I have to get back to that, because how this line got into Matthew is a very interesting problem. He says to the Laos, the people, I'm sorry, this is in Greek and it's very small, so it's taking a while. Okay, I'm guiltless from the blood of this person. And the people said back to him, this is like the most terrible line in the Bible, his blood be upon us and upon our children. Who said that? Can you in your wildest imagination imagine the Jewish people standing around while one of their beloved leaders is being crucified and saying, we'll take all the guilt and let it be on our descendants also. Does that sound plausible to you? And if not, who put that line in there? Well, there's not an immediate answer for this question. But I have a friend who has written a book on the book of Matthew. The book is called Healing the Rift, the Jewish-Christian Rift. And she said at one point in that book, God have mercy on the person who put that line in the book of Matthew, because this has brought persecution down on the Jewish race for 2,000 years. And you can see what this line does. This is making the New Testament narrative into a text of persecution where the victims become victimizers. The Jewish people have now taken on the guilt for the crucifixion, the sacrifice of one of their teachers and their popular leaders. So we have to go back. This is very heavy. I find this kind of chilling. I mean, when I read this line nowadays, it really chills up my spine. It's horrendous to think about it, how much blood has been spilled and how much violence has been caused by inserting that line into a foundational text for the biggest religion in the world. Question. Yes. Yes. That also is a very interesting line. I've been thinking about that of late. Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. On one level, it's an extremely noble thing, and I can easily imagine Jesus saying that. You know, if Gandhi was able to die saying Rama, 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 in the face of the person who killed him, I can imagine Jesus forgiving the people who were torturing him. But on the other hand, I have a deep suspicion about that line, and I think this is not a coincidence that it's the climax of Mel Gibson's movie, which Mel Gibson is both one of the most violent and one of the most anti-Semitic people in Hollywood today. And I haven't seen the movie, and I'm not recommending it. But I understand that people were very moved when that line came on, because what he was saying is the people killing me are not guilty. And who would want to say that? Who's writing this text from the Girardian point of view? See, on one level, it's not Jesus who's writing that text. It's the people who killed him who are writing that text. It's the victimizers who write the texts of persecution. The minute the victim can speak, the system is broken open. It doesn't work anymore. So this is a very, very powerful dynamic. Joy?
So you're saying that the victimizers of Jesus?
I'm basically saying that, and I've got no way to prove it. But let me give you the context for why I say that it was the Romans or the Romanizers who inserted that line in Matthew. Okay, there has been, we're just about right on time here, there's been a very interesting development that Eli started talking to you about, and I want to say a little more about. It's called the Jesus of History movement. It actually goes back to German theologians in the 19th century who invented this concept of Entmythologisierung, which means demythologization. Where they, you know, the Germans are very systematic and can be literal-minded about some things, and they went back to the Bible and said, what do we think really happened here, and how do we know? And they started this movement. Albert Schweitzer was a main proponent of it, but in the last 30 years, it's really shot ahead because they've been able to combine micro-archaeological evidence, sociological theory, and astute textual analysis. And textual analysis, I'm happy to say, is actually a product of classics. That was my old field. We doped out how to figure out what Sophocles actually wrote. the best possible way to do that. And you can apply that to sacred scripture also. And by careful study of the four Gospels, which differ a lot among themselves and even within themselves, they're able to dope out, you know, part of this is very interesting, but it's not totally relevant for us. I'm trying to keep it within the bounds of where it's helpful for us most immediately. But you can tell that there, the earliest text, even if it was a written text, we have not yet found a written copy of. Okay. Now, there are 26 Gospels extant today. I don't know if you knew that. There's several different genres, sayings, Gospels, narrative Gospels. But if you look at them with an unbiased eye as a historian, they have the same historical claim to validity as the four that were chosen by the bishops in the 4th century. And incidentally, we know a lot about that process too, how they threw out some Gospels and kept others. This was a time of tremendous religious diversity. There were groups that we call Gnostics today, about whom who were so suppressed that we knew nothing about them until a young shepherd boy named Muhammad was looking for his goats somewhere near Nag Hammadi. And he threw a rock into a cave to see if his goats were in there, and it went pink instead of bleep. And he figured that it hit a jar of some kind, and he went in and discovered this incredible library of Coptic and other languages, texts that had been hidden in that cave during a persecution by the Gnostics. And the reason I'm mentioning them is that a lot of these religious experiments that were going on were more nonviolent in some ways than the one that we ended up with. For example, the Gnostics were not patriarchal. And you can read a book about that by Elaine Pagel. It's called The Gnostic Gospels. Okay, well, I'm so enthusiastic about all the stuff that I get carried away. I forget where I was. Okay, so the earliest document, quote unquote, that we don't have, but we can infer the existence of, is called Q, because Q is the first letter of the German word Quelle, which means force. Source. Not may the force be with you. May the source be with you. So Q was a set of sayings of Jesus, and it came into existence pretty early, only shortly after the execution. Whether it had written existence or not, we're not sure. Mark is the earliest gospel writer, and he used Q extensively. The other two synoptic writers are Matthew and Luke. They come on about 20 years later. They start adding stuff, Luke and then Matthew, right, Eli? And then John. I guess how it goes. Now, Eli mentioned this fellow John Dominic Crossan, who's been one of the really assiduous scholars bearing down all this material. He says, look closely at the trial scene, and you'll see it migrating. In the earliest phase, Pilate has Jesus and Barabbas there, and some of Barabbas' people come and they say, we want Barabbas back. That's all they say. They never heard of Jesus, maybe. They don't care who he is. It's like the weathermen coming and saying, we want Patty Hearst back. Or something, that you've got one of our leaders. And in fact, Barabbas, as Eli was saying, was probably leading a violent revolution. And that's all we say. There's nothing in there about, you know, crucify him, crucify him. The next version of it, it's not just a few people, it's a crowd. And in the final version in Matthew, it's Laos, the people, the Jews. So what somebody is doing is turning this step by step into a text of persecution where the Jews are responsible for the death of Jesus. So the historical Jesus movement has turned up two things of very grave importance, and this is almost as big as, you know, quantum theory or the 9/11 discrepancies are so big that people aren't paying any attention to them. But we are in this class. The two things are, first, that the Jews, quote unquote, did not kill Jesus. They adored him. They thought he was probably their Messiah. Some Jews had trouble with him for that very reason, undoubtedly the religious hierarchy, and they may have acted in collusion with the Roman authorities. But he was basically executed by Pontius Pilate, who executed thousands of people, and it didn't seem to cost him a night's sleep at any time in his long and bloody career. And so that's one thing, that this idea that the Jews killed Jesus was extremely convenient for the Romans, because they actually did it. And anyone who was trying to spread the religion of Jesus among the Romans would want to make it look that way. Okay, who wanted to spread the religion of Jesus among the Romans? I know that religious education is not. Yeah, Amy? Any other religious studies majors here?
Was that one of the gospel writers?
Yeah. Well, not a gospel writer, actually. But he's a writer in the New Testament, for sure. In fact, I'll give you a hint. His letters are earlier than many of the gospels.
Is it Paul?
Yeah. Yeah. There's a big... Okay, I'm sorry. I get so excited by this stuff. Let me get back to the second most... The other important thing, and then we can come and follow up this track. The other, okay, the first important thing is that the Jews didn't kill Jesus. In fact, what actually happened was the greatest crime, in my opinion, ever committed against the Jewish people was that Jesus was taken away from them, from us, and was made to look, he was made into a club to beat us with for 2,000 years. I'm very upset about this, as you can imagine. I only discovered it about 15 years ago, and I'm still kind of peeved. So this was actually, you've taken my personal little problems aside, it was a horrendous crime against a group of people. Secondly, Jesus was pretty obviously starting a nonviolent revolution, which he called the Kingdom Movement. If he were starting a violent revolution, all of his followers would have been killed along with him. That is how Pontius Pilate and all the procurators operated. They didn't do that to him because his group was nonviolent and they didn't perceive him as a threat. But they knew that Jesus had this enormous following and they could not predict what he would say, so it seemed safer on the whole to kill him. There is another theory that is not particularly relevant for us, but it's interesting that Jesus was actually, in fact, a descendant of David and he was messianic and he thought that he was starting a messianic movement and that was a big threat to the Roman authorities, obviously. Okay, I think I finally got the bit in my teeth. I can slow down a little bit here. So let me, so if Jesus' religion was a religion of nonviolence, and that means he was totally against the sacrificial system, that had another feature to it, and that meant that he was against the ultimate control of the individual by the state, because that's what the temple hierarchy stood for. Ancient Judaism was a religious state, not unlike modern Judaism, and not unlike Tibet. And he was trying to create some freedom for the individual over against the religious hierarchy, and that made the priests nervous because they knew perfectly well they had no other authority. He was trying to get individuals to come into their own relationship with God that was within them. And that's why he said, as the Greek gospel writer said, "Hei basileia ton uranon entos humon," the kingdom of God is within you. And that's a very difficult line to deal with. Teresa of Avila used this line for a homework exercise, gave it to some heavyweights like John of the Cross, people like that, and they couldn't come up with a good essay Yeah, you're right.
Isn't it also translated as
it is.
God is within you and among you?
Yes, it is. Entos humon is in the plural, and it could mean it's already in the world. It could, as a social reality, as you said. It could mean that also. But I don't like that idea as well. That actually puts me in mind, I should say that everything that I've just said has to be, in the nature of the case, somewhat personal and tentative, because, as a colleague of mine here says, it is very difficult to get any traction on any historical reality in that time and place. The destruction in 70 AD was so total that there's very little left in the way of documents, monuments, so forth. Even this ossuary that you may have heard of, with this incredibly exciting discovery that they found this bone coffin, and it says on it, James, brother of Jesus, they still don't know whether that's actually a fake or not. You may have read in the newspapers that it's a fake, but archaeologists are not sure. So I just want to pick up one other part of the story, and that is that evidently, and again, the evidence for this is as reasonable as you can get, but nothing is certain. Evidently, there was a group of Jews who became followers of Jesus, or we don't exactly, we sometimes call them Jewish Christians, but there was a word for them, their own word in Hebrew was Ebionites, from the Hebrew word Ebionim, which means the poor ones. And they were probably led by Jesus' younger brother, James, who himself was murdered very brutally in 62. And these Ebionites, it's been argued by a guy whose work I think sounds pretty good to me. His name is Keith Akers, A-K-E-R-S. He wrote a book called The Lost Religion of Jesus. There's a whole shelf full of books called Lost Christianities, Lost Scriptures, Lost Religion of Jesus coming out now. And I think these titles are very accurate. This religion went lost. That the Ebionites survived down to approximately the 6th century, when, interestingly enough, they were taken up by the Sufis. Their teachings were absorbed into the mystical dimension of Islam, according to Akers. And the reason I'm talking about them is that they were very nonviolent and very, they practiced simple living, nonviolence, complete abstention from animal slaughter, and all of those good things. So it really looks as if that's where the heart and soul of Jesus' religion went, while at the same time, a version of it, an export model, if you will, was being brought to the West by Paul and company. And I'm not saying that this was necessarily a bad thing, because it's a lot better than running around in the woods painting yourself blue and roasting all of your enemies in a big wicker tent, which is what the Germanic tribes were doing at that time. I'm not saying that Christianity in Europe was not an improvement over the preceding polytheistic religion, sometimes called paganism, but it does not seem to have fulfilled the nonviolent potential of Jesus' religion. So what we're going to see next week is a series of waves of rediscovery, where people are going to read even the four Gospels that they had with some sensitivity and see that, you know, Mel Gibson got it wrong. Jesus was very gentle and strong and nonviolent. And you're going to see subsequent rediscoveries of this. And in every stage, it's going to lead to a big conflict with the state, because it's not a state religion, Jesus' religion. It's a religion of the person. And it's going to lead to conflict with the war system, because this is the primary mode in which the state exerts control over the individual, that we can take you and make you lose your life and make you kill another for the purposes of the state. That's the ultimate control that the state will exercise over the individual. And these revelation people coming down the ages every few centuries will be rediscovering both of those two principles by and large. Okay, well, I have, yes. Okay. Why was he killed? It seems like it was pretty much for the same reason, that he was causing difficulties to the temple authorities, and things were very tense at that time. It's only a few years before the Bar Kokhba rebellion is going to break out, and the Jews were a very difficult people to keep control over.
As far as, like, historians for scapegoating, would Judas
come? Yeah, he'd be good. He'd be a good example of that, because then he goes and dies himself.
Yeah, so
like
he kills himself.
He kills himself, so he takes the problem. Like your man.
Yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Paganism was, okay, that's a prejudicial term. I was hoping nobody would notice that I used it. But it's basically the pre-Christian religions of Europe we're calling paganism. Pre-Christian religions, yeah. Yes, Sid?
When do you think the idea evolved in, like, the separation of the individual and God, like how a lot of images of God now are God in heaven and die separate from the body, like someone you go to and feel like subservient and you will never be that good?
Okay, this is unfortunately one of the things that happened to early Christianity to make it more palatable was to create accommodation. And one of the ways that accommodation was facilitated was to say, okay, people, this was all symbolic. So when Jesus says that the Pneuma, the spirit, appeared out of the heavens, it was like in the form of a bird that came down from the sky. Well, I guess it's the opposite of symbolic. It's literalizing what was symbolic and making symbolic what was literal. And, I mean, you have to have some sympathy for people's problems. I was once driving Norman Cousins to a breakfast somewhere. I love name dropping, but it doesn't work with most of you people because you don't know who any of my famous friends were. Anyway, I was driving him to breakfast and he said, what do you think would happen if people took the gospel seriously? And I said, my God, you know, it would spoil your whole day. So the fact is that most human beings need a certain degree of accommodation. And what the essential thing that Paul did was he, because it's going to be a funny kind of word, but he dehumanized Jesus by deifying him. And that was the removal that you're talking about, Sid. And that made it easier for people to say, as you know, when I first heard about Gandhi, I thought, whoa, you know, he's nice, I'm glad he existed, but no relevance to my life. It was the same sort of thing. Paul did that. I'm not even going to tell you that I think he was wrong. But I am going to say that on one level, at least, it was a pity. And on another, much more important level, it's time for us to get over it. That's really what's important now. That's what I think the value of the Jesus of History movement is now. Shannon?
You have said it right after. I was just going to say it's funny because that's such a similar thing that they did with Gandhi in India after he died, you know, instead of, like, making him, you know, an accessible part of the world, they totally froze him up.
Yeah. Yes, you remember that? Remember that comment of Attenborough's where somebody said, oh, Gandhi should not appear as a human being. He should just be a disembodied voice. And he said, I'm not going to have Tinkerbell on the screen. Yeah. It is the same problem. And it made it possible to use a monotheistic system with much higher ethical values than people had at the time, accessible to them. But it was nowhere near realizing for the ordinary person what Jesus had stood for. I think Eli put it very well, that ultimate act of love, of sacrificing your own life because you knew there was no other way that people would understand who you were and what you stood for, that challenge is you know, too much for most people. But it also has to be said that it was not too much for some people, and there have been these revelatory figures who've come up. Probably St. Francis of Assisi is the one who comes to mind most readily, who have said, no, I knew exactly what he did, and I'm going to do the same thing. And I'm glad that Eli mentioned Walter Wink, because he is an important theologian today. Wrote a book, now that was John Deere who wrote a book called Our God is Nonviolent. But Walter Wink wrote a lot of books about how it is just about impossible to read even the four Gospels we've got, which have already been worked over considerably, but even to read them with some sensitivity and think that Jesus was in favor of the Crusades, for example, or persecutions, for example, you have to be, you know, half blind in order to do that. Which it seems there are a lot of people, and they're not all in Alabama either. Okay, so I guess it may seem a little bit anticlimactic, and oh, I may have left my notes anyway, so oh. Isn't that interesting? I don't actually have the notes that I took on your exams. Let me read them over and see if I can get them to you in a condensed form on Tuesday. And what we'll do is we'll just spread out these stacks right now, and you'll have time to come up and get your notes.